tell me it's been 10 minutes. Hi everybody, thanks very much for joining me and for choosing this case study. I've completely changed my mind about what I want to talk to you all about. So the title sort of says Decolonising Strategies for the National Maritime Museum. And then just at the end, I was going to talk a little bit about museum activism. And I realise now that the kind of tone of this symposium is quite different than I had anticipated when I first put my slides together. And I think that you'll probably be more interested in that museum activism than I kind of had originally anticipated. And it very much informs the approach and strategies that I've taken at the National Maritime Museum. But also listening to Uzma and to Temi's presentations this morning, I realized that my thoughts were changing, listening to them, and my thoughts have been changing these sort of last few months about my place in the sector, I suppose, and how I think I can be effective going forward. So since the election, particularly, a lot of us in the culture sector have been, you know, feeling that, you know, maybe we need new strategies, and maybe I've been involved in some more direct action in the last kind of couple of months than I had been previously. And I've been sort of thinking, you know, the sort of job, and then the activism on the side, the balance there might be sort of shifting, and what will that look like in the future year? So I'm at a sort of bit of a crossroads professionally and politically, and so I think the slightly formal thing that I was going to do about like telling you all about kind of institutional change at the museum, which is all quite a top-down process, which I will tell you about because that's what you've signed up for and it's important to, you know, story. And then I'd sort of tacked on a thing at the end about my political activism, which is almost sort of like not the day job, but actually, you know, that stuff is very intertwined. So instead of running out of time to talk about the activism, I think what I'll do is start with that. So I'm going to skip to the kind of end of the presentation and then use that as a way in to start talking about the museum stuff. So after 10 minutes, Jason's going to give me a nod and I'm going to move on to the more formal museum-y sort of museum internal stuff. So this is all the stuff I was going to talk about first, all the stuff about galleries and how we develop them and working class audiences. And then there's a whole load of things that we got funding for, and I was going to tell you all about that. And then I was going to tell you about we've got a black trustee, and then I was going to tell you about museum activism. But that's what I'm going to start with. These are my friends, and this is our Christmas party, which was at the Tate Britain, at the Artist and Empire exhibition, funnily enough, the one that I was talking about yesterday, for those of you who heard that session. So when me and my friends get together, we call ourselves Museum Detox, and it's basically a group of non-white people who are museum professionals based in London museums. And they weren't my friends like 3 years ago. Some of them were kind of professional contacts, and one or two of them were mates. But I came out of a meeting at the museum one day, and as I said, I've been there about 6 years. And I was promoted about 3 years ago. I was running a little team and, you know, attending the more senior sort of meetings that you tend to then be involved in. And when I first joined the museum, it was quite an unusual sort of department because it was run by, so I joined the learning department, the learning and interpretation department, and the side of learning interpretation that I'm in is informal learning, is what we call it in the UK setups. That formal learning tends to be schools and universities, and informal learning is everything else. And as you can see, I'm an informal sort of person, so informal was my natural home. And the museum was sort of on my shit list, if I'm honest, of sort of museums in London. I'm kind of fairly obvious lefty, kind of the type of museums that are my type of museums are sort of social history museums, like the Museum of London. That's my sort of normal sort of scene. And the Maritime Museum is obviously aligned quite strongly with imperial history and the Royal Navy. It's quite sort of got quite a slightly stuffy image. And because of the Atlantic World Gallery, it doesn't have a great reputation with sort of people who are interested in decolonizing things. So I wasn't like busting a gut to work there. And I just happened to kind of go along and talk to them about this program that I thought looked quite interesting. They wanted someone to do a freelance gig on the East India Company Gallery that they were developing. And I thought, East India Company Gallery, yeah, I could probably like make some interventions there. Let me like check these guys out. Maybe they're not all bad. So I went along for a chat about doing this work. And the woman who I met was this like hardcore communist from East London. I was like, what is she doing in this place? This is not what I expected. Much further on the political spectrum to the left than me. And she was obviously like engaged in class war in this organization and had been for about 5 years. I was like, okay, just like a resistance cell here inside the National Maritime Museum. And so I just worked for her for the next 4 years. I'm like massively loyal to her because there's not many people on the hard left in the museum sector. And over the course of those 4 years, you know, I sort of saw the museum through very different eyes than I expected to. I hadn't really expected to stay there beyond doing the freelance gig, let alone become a senior manager there and sort of become institutionalized pretty much in an organism that I was basically hostile to. But, you know, I saw there were a lot of allies, particularly on the learning side of things. And then actually, you know, within the curatorial department and other places, there was some quite interesting thinking going on. So I stayed and became a senior manager. And then I started going to these meetings and I realized, actually, because Andrea was the way she was, most of the people in her team were not white. She had gone out of her way to recruit sort of atypical people from atypical backgrounds in the museum sector. So until she left and I took her job, I'd been working alongside like 5 or 6 other people of color. Suddenly, over time, a lot of them had left. We'd stopped doing a big project that had come to an end that was about the history of slave trade. So a bunch of people left there. Suddenly I was the only white person in a 20-person department, and more than that, a non-white person. And then more than that, obviously the wider museum had always been pretty white scene, but you know, you kind of stay within your clan. You know, museums are quite like universities. You don't have to mingle with people outside your clan that much. So I was mingling well beyond my clan, and I would be like in a meeting regularly, every day in meetings of like 20 senior managers, the only non-white person in the room, and middle managers really. Like, anyway, so there was this one meeting, and it was with a like pretty senior curator. And it wasn't like, he wasn't saying racist things, that never happens. He was just, there was a lot of unconscious bias, and I was sort of, I was actually raising an issue about a conference that we'd had that was about Yinkish on a Bar, and that there had been not a single non-white speaker at that conference, and I hadn't been involved in putting it together, but anyway, I was saying this, and he was like, well, we don't choose our speakers on the basis of their race. And I found myself sort of having this conversation. Anyway, it got quite tense, but quite polite. I came out of the meeting afterwards. I felt really kind of weird about it. I was like, this is not healthy. Like, you know, I can't kind of keep having these kind of conversations. So I decided I needed a detox and a space to just chat to some other people in museums who are not white, who often must find themselves in similar situations. So I just organized a meeting in a pub and put the word out to mainly my white liberal friends at other museums. So do you have any white, like non-white people work at your museum? Can you tell them to meet me in the pub at this time in a couple of weeks? So they're like, that's weird, but if you want, okay. And then some of them didn't say that's weird. Some of them like, I totally get that. Like, you know, you're not invited. You're saying, I can't come to the pub. I'm like, yes, you can't come, but if you know any black people, they can come. So okay, fine. Okay. So we had this one meeting, and like 15 people just came out of the woodwork. It was like, where did these 15 people come? How did I not know you, Chinese guy at the Natural Gallery, or Caribbean woman at like British Museum? Anyway, 2.5 years later, there's 120 of us, and we had a Christmas party, and we decided we were going to do it at Tate. And when we first met up, we were just meeting in dingy little pubs and like whatever. And as the sort of more and more people joined this network, and there was obviously a thirst for it, I thought, actually, we represent amongst us like the most powerful museums in the world. Like between us, we all work at sort of about 40 of the most powerful museums in the world. Some of those people are quite senior, like the head of museums at University College London, Tonya Nelson, who's an African American woman, or Miranda Lowe, who is the most senior curator at the Natural History Museum. Now they're rubbing shoulders with interns who are like 20, who might be part of movements like Black Lives Matter and stuff like that, and they don't get to meet like 20-year-old activists. 20-year-old activists who are normally like just moving into the museum sector do not normally get to like hang with the most senior curator at the Natural History Museum. So even outside of the whole race thing, it's a kind of radical network of people, but also quite a powerful one. So after a while, we sort of said, you know, we want to see this artist and Empire show because, you know, it's quite controversial. We've heard all these things. Let's have a Christmas party there. So one of our who works at Tate said, yeah, okay, we'll do that. And then Tate said, oh, but, you know, you probably want to see it, like, exclusive. And it's, you know, it kind of costs 15 quid to get it. Anyway, long and short of it, they opened it especially for us. And that's quite unusual at kind of, and that gives you a little sense of how unusual a network like that is in the sector. So after we'd been doing all this kind of self-development stuff for quite a while, how am I doing for time? Is it not 10 minutes? Okay, not 10 minutes even.
10.5.
Okay, so after we'd been doing all this self-development stuff for quite a while, we'd done various things. We'd gone on archaeological digs together for the weekend. We'd had like coaching sessions from Gaylene Gould, actually, the woman that if some of you heard earlier from Temi. We'd done some, you know, all self-development stuff and nothing public, nothing formal. We got lots of kind of inquiries from like policy people, diversity people about like, where's your website or where's your thing? We don't have any of that so that we don't have to answer like constant inquiries from undergraduates doing their studies on like black museum workers and stuff like that. So we kind of like totally blow the radar. And but then we sort of said, like, we've got all this agency, what are we gonna do with it? Like, quite a lot of us care about race and representation. Again, even within the Museum Detox Network, people don't, not that many people use the language of decolonizing. Because if you, like, a lot of these people are, might be like a, someone who's a conservator and is obsessed with conservation, happens to be Chinese, kind of obviously thinks about race, but, you know, doesn't necessarily like, isn't part of these dialogues about decolonization, stuff like that. But then there are some other people, particularly the younger ones, Generation Y, as we call them, in the UK, I don't know if that's currency beyond the UK, are pretty passionate about changing things and decolonizing things. And then you get the kind of people like me who are sort of like, got quite a lot of experience, have been around a lot, are a bit institutionalized, but pretty, you know, also quite committed to changing things and kind of know how to, because we know all the levers and, you know, got all these 100 mates at all the powerful museums and stuff. So they said, let's, you know, let's do something a bit more public. Let's, so it's like, well, there's all this anxiety and kvetching and stressing about like not getting black people into museums as audiences, which we're all quite bored of in the sector because we know that a lot of the interventions, as I think Osmo was talking about earlier, are quite bolt-on, like, you know, get audiences in, outreach, all of that stuff. And that practice is actually getting revolutionised at the moment and getting more interesting and kind of going the co-curation route. But museums still generally problematise black people, black audiences. They're a problem. They're a sort of, there's a crease in the furrow when we talk about black people at museums, because it's normally about how can we get more black people in, even if it's a, even if it's coming from a good, you know, progressive, like, you know, democracy and representation point of view, it's still generally kind of like this hunched, kind of tense, kind of worrying diversity problem that needs to be solved. And we don't feel like that about our business. You know, we fucking rock, you know, we're curators and we, you know, we're kind of like quite, you know, we've got a lot of cultural capital. So these people in Museum Detox, they are generally quite cool and they're not used to kind of, they don't align themselves like that. They don't see themselves as a problem. They see themselves as quite powerful, privileged people, a lot of them. So that whole kind of worrying, angsty, kind of brow-furrowing issue of black audiences, they don't kind of, you know, it doesn't ring true to their experience. And so they were like, we decided to do a flash mob, basically. Like, we, a flash mob of black museum workers, will just announce ourselves in a museum as a collective to just let people know that we exist, that there are black curators, and that there's a lot of us. And we'll just, like, it would be interesting just to get our friends and families to turn up and see how many people of colour can we get to turn up in a museum just, like, together at one time, instead of these long projects that are about outreach and, blah, 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 and don't make any difference, but somebody does, like, a big evaluation and then says, like, yes, we got 10 black families to come this one day, hurrah, well done. I said, what if we just, like, made a few calls and just got some people to turn up and just, like, you know, did it in a more sort of punk sort of way. Like, it's not a big strategic intervention, it's not going to change anything, but we just want to see what that looks like. Because one of the things that we realized when we were walking around galleries together, when we'd go to our private views and our meetups and stuff, was that sometimes we would just notice that, like, other people in the gallery would be noticing us. And it was interesting what Temi was talking about earlier about black bodies and that stuff, and they would be looking at us as sort of, clearly we were not like an outreach group, because we, you know, don't look like that. We look like cocky curators and that, walking around together, but we're all not white. So that doesn't make sense. This picture is an unusual picture, if you see like 30 of these people walking around a gallery, because you don't see people of color in big groups in most of these white cube spaces. And so, like, sometimes we'd notice people looking at us curiously, but also approvingly quite often, like, I'm good, that's good, I'm glad to see lots of black people in the that makes me feel better, I don't want to be in this monocultural space, that's a good thing. But normally the white people would not engage us, they would just be looking and sort of, you know, because what are you going to say? Like, why are you all here? But that was kind of what we could see in their expressions, was like, what's this about? But one time we were walking around, this Asian woman came up to us and said, what's this? I want in. Why are you together? I want in. This looks good. And I was like, no, sorry, you can't. We're museum workers. We're having a thing. And she was like, oh, I'm an activist. And in my work, my job is to bring together activists of colour in the campaign sector. And we have a people of colour network for campaigners. And I'm like, okay, you're in. And it's like, okay, this is really interesting. So activists have a network for people of colour within activism, because the campaign sector is apparently really white, a lot like the museum sector. So now I've got a mate in the campaign sector. They know about that black network. Then we're doing this flash mob. So then when we wanted to do the flash mob, we called the campaigns people. And that partly the flash mob came out of the thing that we noticed people looking at us. And so I suppose that, just to go back to flash mob for a minute, we thought we wanted to, I think I was also thinking a little bit about the performativity of it. Like, it, you know, the sort of, I was interested when Temi was saying that she had started doing performance, because I was also a little bit, though I'm, you know, in no way an artist, and we were thinking probably much more around the audience's side of things when we were talking, because a lot of people in the Detox Network are like in the learning departments, or their audience development people, or community engagement people. So we were kind of thinking of it more like that. But there was a little part of me that was thinking of it as an artistic intervention, like just black bodies in the museum all at one time. I know there's a tradition of that, as Temi was talking about, and I know there's a tradition of artists doing things with themselves, about, you know, not more, much more sophisticated than that, but like doing things with themselves and their bodies and inserting them in unusual places. So I was slightly thinking of it like that. Anyway, long story short, that's not everybody. It looks a bit smaller there, but we got on The Guardian, which is our national lefty paper, and one of the young people, Pechu, who's literally about 22, organised a whole social media thing with this woman, Rosie, who had left the museum sector as a press officer and moved over to that organisation I was talking about, the campaigns one, which is called the New Economics Foundation. So her whole job at the New Economics Foundation is to do comms around raising the profile of activists and anti-neoliberal campaigners in the world, and getting them onto the news and into, you know, getting more coverage of people like that. So as an ex-museum press officer, now campaigns comms officer, in her like evenings in between her day job, she did the comms around this, along with this 22-year-old woman who works at London Transport Museum, who's like only one, you know, that's her, she's in her first job. They just smashed all the social media stuff themselves. And so Pechu got called back from London Live, which is our local London kind of television station that kind of covers London. And they said, oh, we want to do a live interview with you about the flash mob. We're like, oh my God, there's only actually 40 of us. Can we really call it flash mob? Okay, maybe there's 60. Some people have wandered off in that picture. But it didn't matter. It was the fact that it was the dialogue around it, that like, why are you doing this? This is a really interesting thing that black people want to come together in museums. And so we did the television interview about it, we did it. And so now we're at a point where, what do we do next? Like, are we, as a network, we're quite a loose network, but actually there's a really interesting conversation happening now where we're sort of private group, but we've got the potential to do some public stuff. But it's really, I think, important how we couch ourselves and frame ourselves and what we decide to do at the next moment, because it's quite easy to slip into the kind of conventions of diversifying the workforce, and I'm starting to do quite a lot of that kind of chat. You know, I'm speaking at the Diversity Arts Council No, I'm actually speaking. Thank God I did turn that down. But I'm going, you know, the Diversity Arts Council kind of policy makers and stuff like that, they're very interested in this group. And obviously we are very interested in increasing the diversity of the museum workforce, because Black, Asian, minority ethnic people are very underrepresented in that in the workforce, which is why we do this. But there's this question about identity politics, and actually I've noticed that contemporary art people in the museum sector are a bit more nervous of joining this network. So there are fewer, for instance, people from Tate Modern who are curators and so forth, or people of colour who come along to this network, than there are, I don't know, young marketing people at the Museum of London, or young marketing person at British Museum, or, you know, curator or whoever at non-art museums. And I've got a hunch that it's because people of colour in contemporary art spaces have got a very different relationship with things like identity politics because of the history of black arts movements and the problematic construction of black artists and black curators. They have to manage extremely carefully their relationship with their bodies, their identity, their selves in relationship to the mainstream, particularly the contemporary art world, because that shit goes deep. And even kind of rocking up to something or being aligned with something or branding something like that, that might smell of kind of identity politics, old school black arts, like, you know, and I've had black people in the museum sector sort of say to me, why do you even have this network? I wouldn't go to that. I don't see myself like that. I face no racism. They're almost slightly annoyed that it even exists. Like, this is retrogressive, that you're taking us backwards. Why does this need to exist? Like, we should be concentrating on, you know, just progressing within the mainstream and not kind of ghettoizing ourselves. I mean, and this is only one evening in 3 months, but, you know, even the idea of spending one evening on 3 months doing something that's like a collective solidarity thing with other black workers is troubling. I mean, for me, it's all about decolonizing. Time-wise?
Spot on, that was your second time.
Great. So these are two other networks that I want to talk about, which are the, actually, one of them is the... It's not a very good slide, sorry. Anyway, that Proud to Be LGBT, that's about queer workers and the first march that museum and gallery workers came together to represent the sector at the Pride London March. And there are loads of queer people who work in museums, but we're not very organised around queer politics or queer identity. Now, there's a queering the museum movement, which you might be familiar with, and then there's just like a security guard who works at the museum happens to be gay. And there's not much between that, the kind of identity of LGBT workers and their self-identity and self kind of understandings, and the quite much narrower but very important and, you know, highly theoretical and very effective queering the museum curation movement. And I wanted to do something that was in between the two, that was, you know, mixture. So, I mean, it's all I, but it's not, it's we. So I started the LGBT staff network at the Royal Museum of Greenwich, which is just, again, like, go to the pub with some people gay and say, no, you're not gay, you can't come. The thing of you're not gay, you can't come, that's quite a big part of the, like, you know, creating a network and solidarity, is that I'm of a certain age, I'm 43, and I'm quite used to the thing of, like, we have spaces for people of colour, we have spaces for this, because growing up, my mother was a journalist, and she's a unionist, and very active in the National Union of Journalists, and I used to see her always going to her meetings of the black members of the National Union of Journalists, and she set up the black newspaper, The Voice, with her fellow black journalists, so this was very normal to me, that you had networks and spaces that were, like, you know, around, that were mobilising around what we now call decolonising, before the post-colonial, the anti-racism movement, whatever. This was completely normal, and I thought this was, a very familiar concept. And now I see again that there's, like, a lot of mobilising around identity, but it was very unfashionable for quite a few years to do anything that was around that. I mean, I was still doing it unfashionably, but there wasn't really, like, you wouldn't, if you said to a young person, like 10 years ago, I think, who worked in museums, do you want to come to a black museum workers thing? They would be like, what's that? Like, politically, it wasn't the thing. Anyway, so the LGBT staff network, although it's quite a queer-friendly environment, museums, in many ways in the sort of liberal institutions, because they are quite liberal and queer friendly, there's a sense of like, it's not needed here, like we don't need to do any work, we haven't really got any work to do because we're all gay friendly individuals and this is therefore this is a gay friendly organisation. But there's no representation of queer sailors at the museum, there's no queering of the museum collections, there's no interrogation of the museum through a queer lens. So what? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So it's yeah. So it's queer friendly in the sense that like people would say like I am not homophobic. I am individually a good gay friendly ally. Yes. Absolutely. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. I'm sort of gabbling, talking fast, but that's what I mean. Is that like. Culturally, the culture of the organisation might feel or think that, like for instance, just to make it clear, when I first said to someone, shall we have a, like when I said to the astronomer, shall we have a LGBT staff network, he said, well, I'm not sure I need it, like I just, everyone's fine and I'm fine and what do we need it for? And my sense is that, well, until we've, like we mobilised our internal audience around these deeper questions, I think we have got a conversation that needs to happen. So that's why we had this network. And just to give an example, the thing about not needing the network, it's like earlier I was asking somebody, where will I go this weekend? I'm saying Gothenburg, and they're like, you know, what's the, and people said here, oh, you don't need, there aren't many actually gay like clubs or nightclubs or anything, because Gothenburg's actually like, quite gay friendly, and so like there's not many, there aren't many spaces specifically for gay like nightlife or whatever, because it's all quite, and I think the museum sex is a bit like that, and in some ways that's a good thing because it's obviously like it's relatively, you know, inclusive, but mobilizing people around the decolonizing and the queering is hard when you're sort of post queer. And so, you know, so anyway, I just wanted to create that space to see what happened. And what happened was, a young man came to one of the first meetings and said, so what are we doing for Pride as a network? And because Pride had just finished, and we're like, I don't know, we're all old, we don't go to Pride anymore anyway, we're too fat to even walk. So he was like, well, no, come on, we should do Pride, and, you know, I'll sort it out. And we're like, yeah, plus there's only like 10 of us, they're not going to make much of an impact. So he said, well, I'll just get all the museum workers from the other LGBT staff networks to join us. And I was like, I don't think there's been a like LGBT museum presence at the Pride before. It's like, okay, well, then we'll be the first. So he organised for 140 queer people from museums to come together and just represent, you know, museums at Pride. It's not a big deal. Everybody loves Pride. It's not hard. But actually, once we got there, there were like a few people did say to me, like, actually, I've never been to Pride before. And actually, like, I've never done anything that's this kind of out in the sense of like representing myself as a queer person in a public space, and it was like a thing, you know, and so it was kind of a thing. And the other thing is me at a rally, just that's anti-cuts rally. I was talking about the public sector and the squeeze on public spaces earlier, and the sort of moving a little bit more into direct action and campaigning. So I'm involved in the Museums Association, which is our sector kind of, you know, umbrella body for represents museums. And I'm just like a members rep. It's a bit like being a rep for a union or something. And I was representing the museum at an anti-cuts rally at Trafalgar Square, which cuts were about libraries being closed all over the country. And so library workers were coming out marching in defense of museum libraries, and museum workers were being allies. So this was all to say that basically I'm kind of, this is a little bit my journey as a kind of museum activist. And this is stuff that I don't do, obviously, in my job, 9 to 5. But it relates very much to interventions I'm maybe come out in my work and my practice. And on the one hand, I'm getting more and more like that. And on the other hand, institutions are generally becoming more commercial because of commercial pressures, and becoming more sort of gently, the public arts sector is becoming privatized by increments. And so how do you operate effectively within institutions that are becoming more like that, and I probably have less of the kind of like massively entrepreneurial skills, or I'm just less interested in those kind of areas of work, and I'm more interested in like good, you know, old-fashioned social justice stuff and audiences and diversity and decolonizing and all the like very public sector things that museums increasingly have less space for. So how do I, on the one hand, manage a career that is, you know, gently going upwards in that, you know, traditionally institutionalized hierarchical sort of mode, while kind of, you know, having a night job that involves sedition and, like, you know, social unrest and making, you know, doing the change. And I guess the way that it looks at the moment is that I'm the state-sponsored arts activist, and I've taken this, joined this program to become a, you know, it's like to create Black Museum Directors of the Future. The Arts Council has created a dedicated program for people of color, and I'm going to go to Birmingham Museum and Art Gallery and be head of interpretation there for a year to think about how to decolonize their collections and reinterpret their collections in a dismantle colonial kind of model of the museum, as they're about to do a lot of work over the next 5-10 years, rethinking all of their permanent galleries. So that's at the moment how I'm doing that. But what will happen at the end of that year? Will I go back to the museum and Greenwich and, you know, sort of continue to operate within that institution? Or will I just come out completely and become more someone like Temi, who operates outside of institutions? Or will I go off to Queens and hunt down Uzma and try and get in on her? A bit of action that's going on over there. Sounds good. So how that relates to, that's a bit of coverage of the things. And this is another bit of, I really haven't spoken about the National Maritime Museum at all. I'm going to get back to Maritime Museum because I do want to talk about it. Just to tell you that there's another network, and this thing about Black, it's also important that Black workers become more senior in the sector. So on the one hand, I've got that thing going on that, like, we need Black directors of museums, we need Black directors of national museums, we need a Black director of the British Museum. So on the one hand, I'm trying to kind of force myself into that box of, like, no, I will be that role model type who kind of, you know, raises us up, and I should be, because there's only so many of us at my age and my generation who have, you know, we're in the system, we need leaders to step up and, you know, do all of that. But I'm not sure really I'm that type, you know, I'm not really that kind of figurehead type. So on the one hand, I kind of, you know, for my own selfish professional reasons, want the advancement and promotion and all of that. But on another side of me, I'm thinking, eh, Trump is like president of the States. Like, what is the point of me chipping away at becoming like senior manager and then like maybe slightly more senior manager, and then like maybe in 30 years time I'll be ahead of a department, or just as I retire I might get to direct like a rubbish provincial museum. It's like, not rubbish, lovely. And meanwhile by then we'll have like no food to eat and there'll be no water. But you know, I might have decolonized museums by about 3%, and I can put that on my gravestone. So that's sort of like, this network is, this quote is from a female museum director, and yet another network that I'm at, haven't got much of a personal life, another network that I'm in is called the Women Museum Leaders Network, and the 50 most powerful women in British museums have made a network for themselves called Women Leaders Museum Network, something like that. And for the last 10 years, they meet up and go on a very expensive retreat to a boutique hotel and just kind of talk amongst themselves and support each other and you know, do what people do in self-support networks. They're very busy, you know, this includes women like the director of the Imperial War Museum. So these are, you know, top captains, that's a very masculine thing, captains of industry, you know, captains of museum industry, directors of museums, basically. And they're in a minority, mostly it's men at the top of British museums. So they felt like, as the only women in the boardroom often, they wanted to be around other women in similar situations, so they set up this network. Anyway, after 10 years of meeting with each other, they said, this was an extremely closed network. You could only, you know, it was invitation only. So after 10 years of meeting, they said, all right, this has been great for us. This has all helped our careers. Let's do something about succession planning. So they got hold of some money from Cultural Leadership Fund and said, we want to create a network of 100 women, generation below us, that is going to mimic our network, and we'll get people to nominate people into them, and we'll make clusters of 20 women around the country, 5 different clusters, and they will be You know, they'll go on this program for a year, Confidence Choice Connections, it was called. You'll do a bit, get a bit of coaching. But again, the main point was spend time with other women who are museum leaders. So I got nominated into the London one. And what we did was to use our pocket money that we were given to create a conference for women in the wider sector, because we were a bit like queasy about the kind of, there was quite a lot of quite politicised feminists in my network, and also the director of the Museums Association, who's a very powerful woman in the museum sector, called Sharon Heal. And we all decided that it would be more interesting to have like quite serious interventions about kind of patriarchy within the sector, rather than you know, more individualised sort of promotion of ourselves and stuff. I mean, obviously, don't get us wrong, we've got raging egos, we all want to be like majorly successful, but we also felt like, well, we could just do that, but then there's much deeper issues and political issues around patriarchy that would just be stay in place, and we'd just be the exceptional few women who got, you know, further. So we had a conference with the invited Shami Chakrabarty to speak. She's was until recently the head of the human rights organization Liberty, and anyway, so this conference, which we invited everybody to, anybody could come to it, you didn't have to be in a closed network, that sparked now a series of kind of campaigning workshops around feminism in museums and feminist museum leaders. So one of the things that happened at that conference was that we asked a sociologist, Nirmal Pouar, who's at the Goldsmiths University and the Centre of Feminist Research, to do a kind of pilot ethnographic study that she had done for female MPs and female, I think, senior civil servants and things like this. And she'd written a book called Space Invaders about what happens when women and non-typical people invade the spaces that are not normally, that they're not normally in. So she did this kind of pilot study of female museum directors, invaders. And she interviewed, they remained anonymous, but she interviewed 6 or 7 museum directors who were women, and they told her, you know, the truth. And then she shared it with in her speech, but obviously completely anonymized. So some of the things that they would say to her, but they would never say, you know, out loud normally, were these sort of things. Martin Roth, yeah. Yeah, certainly not localised to museums, and we're certainly not the first people to tackle it in any way. In fact, in a way, museums are quite old-fashioned.
Yeah.
Museums.
You know, I think that museums are one of the places where we don't talk about these issues. That is, I think, is the problem. Like, we do that when it's called, when it's about recruiting, like, outside, like museums, but outside.
Mm. Break into. It's very clubbable, but it's also very difficult to kind of. Okay, now I'm going to kind of, in about 5 minutes have I got?
That'd be great.
Yeah, in 5 minutes I'm going to trot through the title and actual thing that was advertised that you probably actually wanted to come to. I don't know, I hope there's not loads of you who are like, when is she going to talk about the Maritime Museum? and that was all I was here for. Didn't want to hear about anything, these other things. Okay, so the Endeavour Galleries. Basically, the museum is embarking on this massive project, Endeavour. And as a lot of public funding is, drying up, quite a lot of museums are in crisis about how they're going to sustain themselves financially in the future. The Maritime Museum was pretty far-sighted and got ahead of a lot of that by applying for a massive fund of money from the Heritage Lottery Fund, just as a lot of people were getting quite nervous and kind of not trying to expand and just trying to cut things back and, you know, like lay off curators and simplify and get smaller. Maritime Museum had a completely different policy. We were like, it's a land grab. That's just like, get big. Just like try and get loads of more money and loads of more and consolidate. And maybe some of these small museums will close, but that's not our problem. We just get. So we're opening four new galleries. I mentioned them yesterday. But in the process of doing those galleries, a lot of the, what I would call the sort of the, you know, just the kind of progressive movements in the museum sector, under which until recently we would have called a lot of this, the language that museums use. When I said museums don't talk about decolonizing, I mean museums talk constantly about diversity and equality, but they don't use that particular word, decolonizing, and they don't talk about the kind of more radical and epistemological challenge that often. I mean, some clever curators do and stuff, but I mean, it's not like a thing. If people talk about race, they generally talk about diversity. So the diversity bit of the Endeavour project was really important because it released, I mean, you know, because it's important, self-evidently, but also because it became very much part of the arguments in order to convince the Heritage Lottery Fund that the museum was deserving of their money, because one of the things, the Heritage Lottery Fund wasn't giving all of the money, but it was giving one kind of crucial bit of the money. And of that 5 million, most of it was going to be spent on walls and cases and, you know, the actual infrastructure of building this stuff. But there was a crucial, much cheaper, but really important turning point, which was about 500,000 of it was going to be given for what they called institutional change programs. So like, we want to see the museum become a more democratic space, and you have to spend 500,000 on that stuff. But more than spending the money on it, unless we're convinced that that's going to happen, we're not going to release this other 5 million, which will then in turn release the 20 million. So in a way, it was basically this 20 million pound expansion was in part turning on the museum's ability to demonstrate that it was going to become a space that was more relevant to black people. And it sounds like I'm making a big jump there, that like it was 20 million was hanging on this, but actually that's kind of what it came down to, because that bit was the bit that was hardest to evidence and which the Heritage Lottery Fund was most interested in and most a probing of the museum on it, because of the history of the museum having made galleries like the Atlantic Worlds Gallery, which had been funded by the Heritage Lottery Fund, which had been in many ways seen as a disappointment, because a lot of things was not very radical. It wasn't doing what it was meant to do, and it certainly didn't succeed in, you know, in attracting black British people to the museum, or making people feel that it was representative or had decolonized history in any way. So, got these galleries, and one of the decolonizing strategies was curate them in a different way. You know, everybody's curating in a different way anyway now, so instead of it being just the curator decides objects, the curator will not decide things on their own, they'll decide them with members of staff from around the museum, like learning people like me. So there was learning advocates in every gallery team. Everything was decided by teams as a whole. There was interpretation experts on the team. But also, there would be a lot more co-curation of the permanent gallery. Now, co-curation is pretty normal for like a small community project in the corner, and you go, oh, we got local youth group in, and they made like a nice, pretty thing over there about, I don't know, a young person's perspective on maritime things, and we will put that in the corner and it'll stay out for a couple of months and it'll come down. But what's much more unusual is to have co-curation in 20 million pound permanent galleries that are going to stay out for 15 years and that go to the heart of issues around British Empire. So we, for instance, with the Pacific Gallery, will do, have done quite a lot of consultation with source communities. So Pacific Islanders, Maori people who are in the diaspora, who live in Britain, came to the museum, told us what they thought about the legacy of Captain Cook and how they wanted things represented. Then meanwhile, we've got not very much kind of in the ethnographic collection that actually relates to Pacific Islanders or indigenous cultures of those worlds. We've mainly got compasses and shit that Cook had, or like bits of stuff that relate to maritime story. And then we've got like maybe some tapa cloth, some a portrait of a half-naked Pacific woman, and then like all these really beautiful oil paintings of impressive white dead admirals. So if you're trying to make that story look representative and more interesting to that Pacific Islanders community, or just like anybody, frankly, who might not want to see loads of pictures of dead white admirals, but all you've got is like, you've got all these really impressive brass instruments and like great oil paintings and all this really rich stuff on the one hand, and then you've got like this small, shitty little list of tapa cloth that doesn't actually look that great. It's actually not that easy to make that tapa cloth do all that work. So one, you know, doing the contemporary art thing, talked about yesterday, commissioning there, and there's quite a lot of anxiety on the part of the team who's, you know, going to manage that commission about whether there's too much pressure on the commission, whether there's a sort of neurotic hope that that commission is going to decolonize the entire gallery. And also, what else about the Pacific Gallery? What else? So also we need to be contemporary, have contemporary relevance, and that is about decolonizing, because if you talk to Pacific Islanders about what's happening now, like presumably this is not a frozen community in time, and they weren't just stuck there in Captain Cook's time. There is a whole other world of stuff that has happened since, and this is a growing, you know, mobile living community. How do you represent that in a maritime museum that isn't an ethnographic museum, but that has got this heavy weight of empire? And if you don't represent it, then that's a very problematic gap that you're leaving. So we also just went down to the local shopping mall, do a consultation there. We just got loads of Pacific objects out on a table, hoped that people would be curious about that, because the Lewisham shopping mall, which is not that far from the museum, is just in terms of social class and different types of spaces, millions of miles away. So just even going two stops on the train and going to the mall, hanging out with some objects, is going to start different types of conversations that will then inform what happens in that gallery. And actually, after standing there for half an hour, would you believe it, a Maori guy just came by, and he was there in Lewisham Shopping Centre, and he was like, yeah, what you got this stuff? My dad was head of the Maori Repatriation Society. I'm like, no way. We totally come to the mall more often. Did not expect that. And then we just got into a fascinating conversation about Maori repatriation, because he'd seen this like object and caught his, you know, like he didn't come out for a pair of trainers. So that was good. I'm gonna wrap this up now.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Right. So those are the kind of categories that the HLF talk in terms of, which is working class and Black, Asian, minority, ethnic. And then we kind of put that to our own audience segmentation that the marketing department might have got all this expensive research about audiences and local audiences and how they operate in the museum. And then you kind of, you know, you basically do a logarithm trying to find out which categories that we have got the most working class people in, which ones have got the most Black people in them. And then you meet the target of the HLF by saying, okay, we're going to concentrate on these categories because you've said you want to see more Black and working class people, so we're going to get the explore and discover crowd, which is basically normal people, as far as I can work out. Like, they're described as people who like going to the watch telly and like have a nice time at the weekend. It's like everybody. Anyway, apparently there are lots of Black people in that group, so we've said that we will target them. And then this is what I'm going to finish on. Okay, very quickly, rethink migration as a thing, where we rethought migration in a gallery, but I haven't got time to say more than that. This is important because this is, I suppose, something that made me feel like decolonizing, I'm starting to see some changes, more important ones, which were that when I first got there, this is an image of Indian sailors, obviously, and when I first got there, the sort of thinking about collections and display about basically finding and platforming Black histories, non-white seamen stories, all of that stuff was done one way, and that way was that like probably is not going to get done, but if the East India Company Gallery is being opened, then I don't know, we'll maybe do a little bit of research and try and find some stuff in the gallery, in the collections, that relates, that we can at least get something out in the exhibition. So it wouldn't be like loads of PhDs going on or something, but like something, and that you get some sort of representation in that gallery. But there was no non-white curators, there were no really curators who were massively interested in, I mean, there's a curator of world history who was responsible for the East India Company Gallery and for the other one, but basically no decolonizing curators. Now time has moved on. We've got this guy, Aaron, the top picture, Aaron Jaffa, and his PhD was in on the history of resistance and mutinies in 18th century Indian like ocean. So now we've got someone there, and then the other guy is Aminul Haq, and he is an academic again at Goldsmiths. Goldsmiths is a bit of a theme here. Goldsmiths is a university not that far from the museum. But more importantly, he's a sociologist and a educationalist, and he's working, his own personal background is working class Bangladeshi guy who's raised in housing estate in East London. And he writes about the third generation of Bangladeshi young people in Britain. And he's written a book about like Islam, Muslim identity and Bangladeshi young people. So that's his area, and he's basically an activist on behalf of youth and Bangladeshi youth. And he's now a trustee of the museum. And that matters, because that picture of those Indian sailors, many of whom's descendants would be Bangladeshi, who'd be now living in East London and may well be Bangladeshi, but might actually not know about their forebears, that display would just come and go. And there would be maybe no curator who actually was intellectually doing any decolonizing, and there would be no one at governance level who was necessarily clued into this stuff. So now to have the curator there, the collection's more known about, and the trustee, that's the kind of, you need that thread running all the way through. And that trustee was appointed partly because of a kind of awareness around these issues. It wasn't a coincidence that he's a person of colour. There was no other person of colour on that board, and of the person of colour that they could get, you know, in the past they had been like the Indian woman who was a mayor of Greenwich, but she wasn't like super skilled up in decolonising thinking. This guy is like a neat decolonising ninja. And now he's on the board, so that's progress for me. And you know, I was probably one of the happiest days of my working life when I heard that he'd been appointed, because I knew he was up for it, but I didn't know it would necessarily happen. So, over to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you so much. Super interesting. I have a question about the money that the museum wanted. How did the to get the rest of the money? Mm-hmm. What kind of results were they looking for? How did you report that you were going to reach or going to be more democratic?
That's a really good question, and means I can unlock some of the strategies material that I meant to talk about. So, so the things that we said will change, there was a whole raft of, in fact, I'll go back to this slide because it's kind of in there. There was a whole raft of strategies that we'd said we would use to spark institutional change, and that bit of money, the $500,000 bit that I talked about, was called the activity plan, which basically means all the other stuff, the cases and walls, is hardware, and the stuff that we're going to change in terms of decolonizing is software, and let's call that software the activity plan. That's just the jargon that the funder uses to talk about activity that you're going to do. So these were the four different areas that we said we'd focus on. Removing barriers to make the museum more accessible. So there's a whole raft of stuff where people just don't come in anyway, don't come across the threshold, because there's not only is there nothing actively inviting them, there's a whole load of stuff repelling them. So some of that work is literally about signage, what the museum looks like, branding, external stuff that needs to be changed and get more democratic, so it's not only that very narrow group of people who are typical of museum goers, not just to this museum, but to most museums, the highly educated white people are overrepresented as museum audiences, and that's not their fault, you know, that's a structural thing. So remove the barriers, and there's a whole load of stuff that happens around that. Creating community ownership, representing individuals. And so that representing invisible histories bit is probably the bit that aligns most tidily with the sort of decolonizing conversations we've had and this collaborating to create a social inspiring space. So creating community ownership meant things like when I said that the Pacific Islander groups would co-curate some of the exhibition, would do not the whole of that Pacific gallery, because there's lots of reasons why not, but there's two points in that gallery where it will say, you curate this, and they'll start to have different type of ownership and leverage and, you know, intellectual ownership of that process. There's a whole bunch of stuff that's happening like that, which is like co-curation of projects. So that International Slavery Remembrance Day that I mentioned in the talk yesterday, that happens every year, normally like someone like me will book the speaker, someone like me will take out an advert in The Voice or something like that, ethnic newspaper, and then we will create the event or curate the event, and then we will sell it to the people that we think are the target audience. Whereas this year, because now we're co-curating things and becoming more participatory, about 9 months before International Slavery Remembrance Day was coming around, we went to talk to the Liverpool Museum, who are probably the most successful in decolonising themselves of any museum in the UK, and said, how do you do International Slavery Remembrance Day, because yours is really good and it's really meaningful. We then came back to like the Caribbean Social Forum, who's a Caribbean network that's near the museum, and said, we're doing this event in 6 months, what do you want to do with it? How should we do it differently? They watched the curator tour that was planned, or the first version of it. They said, these are the things that we don't like about the curator tour. This is not good enough. This is not interesting enough. This is boring. This thing, you know, they curated his curator tour, if you want. And then they said, like, we had some quite tense conversations, actually. I remember this one where a woman had come and said, we'd been giving them taster sessions, different things that happened on the day. About an hour into the day, she said, I just don't like this. I just don't like white people telling me my history. This is really uncomfortable. I don't like you white people standing there as authorities telling me my history. Why don't you have any black people in this museum? And why are you even the people who are telling me this history? And as a person of colour in the room, who's also a member of staff, that's a sort of conversation that's my job to sort of like facilitate those conversations. So it's much better to have those conversations rather than that people think that woman not know this museum exists, not know that there's history, that she's interested in it, and then maybe accidentally come one day and not like it. It's much better to obviously thrash all that out and then say, all right, I hear you. Like, you want different things on the day, we'll do it a bit differently. But we're still a museum, so these are the things that have to still stay in place, but we'll come in this direction. So then this year, when the actual International Slavery Remembrance Day happened, meant that, one, we got the most famous black historian in the country to be the keynote speaker. He's a guy called David Olusoga, who's got a big BBC television series about black history in Britain. And he's like really handsome, that helps, and he's really famous. So that was one thing that people wanted. And the other thing was that about 100 people came from the Caribbean Social Forum themselves. So the day was not just people who were coming for the first time to the museum, as it normally is, and then going away again, often until the next International Slavery Remembrance Day. It was at least 100 of the people there had co-curated that day and had a very different relationship with the museum intellectually, because they had that conversation. And so the day felt different. It meant that when kind of David was coming, he was more almost being greeted by Pamela from the Caribbean Social Forum than he was by the museum people, because it was more, was almost more like the museum was kind of getting out of the way, and the Caribbean Social Forum was engaging directly with their own speaker. And do you know what I mean? So that's one of the ways. And in terms of evidencing the numbers, that's hard, you know. We might not reach those targets, and the HLF might say, give us your money back. You didn't show results. So, and it's quite important that the funder does hold you to those things.
because it's basically public money, you know, for the Heritage Lottery Fund, the people who buy those tickets, the lottery holders, they're mainly working class people, so they want to see that, like, basically the people's money is being spent on things that are going to benefit the people, quite rightly. So those are, I mean, that's sort of, I don't know if that answers your question.
Thank you. Let me just check whether our colleagues, again, are standing downstairs in the cold, because we are over time, but they may be over time. So please, go ahead with your question.
Very, very inspiring. maybe in this audience group, maybe many people, several people are working in museums or cultural institutions or even school teachers. But I think in Sweden, I mean, from my observation, almost 50 years behind from what you are doing, probably in terms of diversity work. Maybe anybody could maybe oppose to my observation, but for example, there is one agency called Kulturinvest, and I used to go to check how many people are having different backgrounds, and 80 of 80 are white people, actually. So it's not really easy to bring up this kind of a diversity issue, actually. So I'd like to maybe point out that maybe on that level, maybe removing barriers to make the museum more accessible is quite a high aim, but maybe here, maybe recognizing barriers should be the first step, actually. So that was sort of my reflection. And many people are quite blind to recognize colors, actually. And saying, oh, it's very unfair to say, actually. I want to discuss about this, but it has been quite difficult, actually.
Mm, mm. I mean, I think everybody's at, you know, wherever the context is, whether the country or the city or, you know, the sort of the microcosm of within a museum, the sort of sense of, like, being ahead or being behind, it's not, you know, I would say don't feel disheartened about, like, they're ahead and we're behind, because just wherever you're at, whatever your interventions are relevant for your starting point, and it's not that, like, this is some sort of pinnacle of, you know, progressiveness, and that Sweden is here. It's not an awe that you have to go through the same developmental stages. I mean, sometimes we look at the group, the Museum Hugh group, which is based in the States, and they're a network around, who, you know, network and mobilise around Black Lives Matter and around museums. And their speaker comes over from Brooklyn Museum sometime, Monica, the founder, and she's an incredibly dynamic, like, force of nature person. And then we feel like, oh God, we are like this hunched, ridiculous bunch of mole people, and she's like this Oprah Winfrey of the museum world, and we're like, we're doing nothing, and Monica's doing everything, and Brooklyn Museum was like amazing, and we're not even fit to lick the poo on their shoes, and, you know, so this, and also you go to conferences and people talk about their amazing things, and you're like, God, they're amazing, and then, like, back at the, you know, back at the ranch, we're bitching and moaning all the time about how shit we are, and how shit we are on diversity, and, you know, how we're not making progress nearly fast enough and stuff like that. So don't, you know, please don't take away from anything that is happening here that you think Sweden is, like, not able to reach the great heights of this stuff, because it's not like that. It's wherever you're at, whatever you're doing is effective. But I think you're very right as well that recognising stuff is, you know, people aren't even recognising there's an issue. It was like with the LGBT groups I was talking about, that was quite a big step, in some ways the biggest step, to say, like, but that's got to raise our consciousness here, people. I think woke is what the Americans say. They're not woke.
I'll take your final, or we'll take your final responses.
Sure, yeah.
Response.
Is that okay?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. But I think what you're raising is a very important issue.
I've had such a conflicted relationship with this microphone the last 2 days. But I think what you're saying is very important. And I think what Sarah is saying is equally important, to look to these other examples to look for strategies, right? And it is always very difficult to have, all you need is a small crack. Like, you literally just need a small crack for light to come in and for you to make that change. And maybe even utilizing some of, I mean, what I think is so refreshing about Sarah's approach is that it really is, you really are an activist who's now in an institution, and you're using activist strategies that we usually use outside of institutions to organize and to change. So to maybe even find, like, you know, just thinking of it like a practical thing, like finding other people who are in the museum world, right, who may be looking for those kinds of different conversations to happen. And it may be that you don't find too many other Asians or blacks or, you know, whatever it might be, but just finding allies first to start the conversation. And then asking them, as she did, to find their friends who are people of color in their institutions, and have, if in fact they exist, which they probably do, right? They are, people are there. You have to find them and to begin to start those networks of conversations. And then for the rest of us who are here, to support that, right? Rather than feeling like that is taking away from our jobs, right? Because actually what it's doing is it's enhancing all of our work. So I think it's important to kind of think through this as a strategic sort of and a tactical kind of way, and something that all of us are part of, not just you, right? So then all of us become part of that supportive network to ensure that there is a different kind of discourse. The only way you're going to get different audiences in to see this work is if you have different faces representing administration, right? We have the same conversation at schools all the time. And in academics, like, how do we see this? But again, just speaking to your point, you're absolutely right. The glass ceiling patriarchy exists in the museum world as well as everywhere else. But I think there's something specific happening in museums, which is distinct from what's happening in business, which is distinct, you know? Because when I go to museums, like, most people at, like, lower management or mid-management, or even the contemporary art world, like the gallerinas, like the gallery folks, are mostly women. But the moment you look at directorship, it's mostly men. And so I think that is, there is a glass ceiling there that certainly needs to be kind of addressed. But yeah, we need to all support this endeavor right here.
Thank you, Sarah.